Oh, I can see you consumed a lot of coffee, so people are more lively than normal. Normally, people get sedated after the conference, and so you can keep talking. They just feel, but now you are full of life. So, being full of life, I'm very pleased to be here. I'm Prodromos Tsiavos from Athena Research Center, and the panel we have here today with us is called the Infrastructure, Services, and Tools. And we have the great pleasure to have with us our three esteemed speakers. We have Peter Dorn from Danz, KNAW. We had a long discussion as to how I should pronounce it, but basically it's the Academy of Arts and Sciences. Peter is going to tell us more about different forms of data sharing in the context of life sciences, or genomics, should I say? No. Okay, it's a surprise. Then we have Stelios Piperidis from ILSP, from Athena. We have working with Stelios for some years now in different projects related to text and data mining, like Clarin or Open-Minded, MetaShare. And finally, we have Jordi Rambla, who comes from CRG, Center for Genomic Regulation. All three speakers, they are going to cover different aspects of how do you actually share data. This is a crucial issue in the context of infrastructures. Because infrastructures by themselves are the kinds of instruments that we're using in order to share our data, but also expose our data to the world. They're also a key instrument for the implementation of the European policies with regards to open data. So enough for me. I leave the floor to our speakers. So the word is to you, Peter. Thank you.
Is this now working? Yes. I also prepared a presentation. Is it on the computer? That would be handy. I'm still a bit sweaty from walking over from the hotel where the RDA main conference is in the next few days. As you see, the title of my presentation is Open If Possible, Protected If Needed, Services and Tools for the Sharing of Research Data, both in the Netherlands and Europe. These are the topics I plan to talk about, so not in particular about data sharing in the life sciences. Danz was actually set up more to service originally the humanities and the social sciences, but the life sciences is becoming an increasing section of our services. I will show that in a moment. So three main topics. Although, as I couldn't be here in the morning, I suppose that a couple of things that are there under the first topic may already have been said, so I will be brief on that. Then I will go into some experiences that we have on sharing research data at Danz. And then finally, I was also asked to say something on what the Science Europe Working Group on Research Data is doing, which is a working group that I happen to be sharing. And Science Europe is the organization of research funding organizations and big research performing organizations in Europe. So I will be brief on topic number one, but still a couple of words there, as they provide more or less the context. Perhaps you know or remember that the Netherlands had the EU presidency in early 2016, and open science was then put as an important subject. In April 2016, an open science conference was organized by the ministry, and that was also perhaps the occasion at which open science became an element of the political agenda. So a couple of things have happened since then that you can read on this slide. Second important development, I think, is the General Data Protection Regulation. That is to replace the current Data Protection Directive of 1995, recently, well, last year, officially published. Research has lobbied quite hard to take away a couple of the worries that we had. The main worry that the GDPR would be so strict that it would be an impediment on the sharing and use of individual data for research purposes. Many organizations, including also Science Europe, lobbied there in the area to keep data available for sharing. So in the meantime, this GDPR has been published, 99 articles on 88 pages, passed European Parliament last year in April. It will come into force in May 2018. A couple of differences I wrote there on this slide. GDPR will become a European law, unlike the former directive. The right to be forgotten is an important element. There is some other things there, but perhaps an important one is that there may be exemptions for the scientific use of data, but they have to be formulated by the countries. So a couple of things will stay the same as well. Again, I will go quickly through this because of the limited time. And say now a few words on the sharing of research data at DANS, on focusing on these three topics. First of all, Data Archiving Network Services is an institute of the Dutch Academy of Arts and Sciences, as has just been said, but co-funded by the Netherlands Funding Organization for Research, NWO. And I didn't put that in the acronym additionally, because it would be even longer. Our mission is to promote and provide permanent access to digital research resources. And we have already quite a bit of history. Our first predecessor dates back to 1964, which was the Steinmetz Foundation, later Steinmetz Archive, for the social sciences. Our motto is open if possible and protected if necessary. We once had umbrellas to make that subject clear, although with umbrellas it is exactly the other way around. You close them if they are not necessary and you open them if they are. So you close them exactly the other way with data. We have a couple of services which I'm not all going to mention, but perhaps the most interesting thing is how data is actually shared. And on this slide you see the development of the data sets that are in the archives since 2012. Well, the history is much longer. You see a gradual grow until indeed about 2005, when there was really a takeoff of data sets. These are the past 6 years. And with the different colors, I try to indicate the openness or the closeness or restrictions that apply to the data. And as you can see, there is really a substantial growth, both in absolute but also in relative terms, of the number of data sets that are openly accessible. Now, I must say, registration is required for a big chunk of that. That has to do with the past. We fairly recently also introduced a fully open license, but it appears that only few researchers would like to change the license to complete open access. And the portion that is protected for some reason often has to do with either privacy considerations or with the protection of cultural heritage. We have quite a few archaeological data sets, and if we would make them available in all their detail, the amateurs could easily go to the locations with their metal detectors and other devices and disturb the antiquities, although they are not as rich as they are, for instance, in the country of my neighbor here on the left-hand side. But they would become even poorer. I would like to go into one very specific example, which is by a Dutch linguist, or actually a historian of language and journalist, who has built up a private library of, well, the equivalent of about 40 bookcases, mainly on literature and linguistics, some 160,000 digitized books and journals and articles. And the problem with that is that, well, this is allowed to do according to the Dutch copyright law of 1912. You are allowed to make copies for private or home use, but it's not allowed to share this information with researchers for scholarly use, and it is not even allowed to deposit his digital collection in a digital repository. Now, in the past few years, several reports on text and data mining have appeared. You see a couple of examples here, of which the main, let us say, idea is that actually copyright law should be changed in order to allow text and data mining for research purposes of bodies of information of different kinds. In the Open Access Week, we decided to, where the motto was last year, commit to putting open in action, to make this like a spearhead of some activities, and to see whether we could make this this collection available for reuse as an, let's say, as an example. And well, what we did, as the copyright law is not being changed, is contact the publishers and see if we could get some kind of arrangement with them, whether it would be possible within the existing regulation to do this. And so far, I see I'm a slide ahead, they have been willing to cooperate, although it will be quite a road to go, because there is so many different publishers involved in these 160,000 works. We are also debating this now with, for instance, the Dutch Royal Library, who says, yeah, if it were possible to do this within the existing copyright law, then perhaps there is a reason for the publishers to resist change. So we'll see. Then another activity we are working on at DANS is what has been labeled data tagging. One of the problems that we witness is that many researchers have very limited awareness of legal privacy requirements, both of under the current legislation and under the General Data Protection Regulation. And our data archive staff, who check the data that come in, they have limited possibilities to check all those deposited data on potential privacy infringements. So a data tagging system would be very useful if it were possible to tag data with the degree of privacy that applies to them. It would raise the awareness among researchers. The system that we propose is to use a structured question and answer system to establish whether protection is required and to what level, and to make that, of course, compliant to both the Dutch law and the European GDPR. The approach is based on an approach that was already followed by, or originally developed at Harvard University, at the IQSS, the Institute of Quantitative Social Science, where Dataverse is one of their products, to have this system of, let us say, a gradual increase of the degree of privacy that is needed. And the approach would be, or is, to have a questionnaire. The person tagging the data answers a series of questions from a dynamic interview application designed to elicit the key properties of a given data, of, well, not a given, but his or her data set, while minimizing the number of questions presented. And then you assess what degree of protection would be necessary, and you could do that automatically, but we think that a fully automatic assignment will be difficult, and there will always be required a human being to check whether that is a good recommendation. So we would plan to use the tagging system more as a recommendation system. Last few words, if I'm allowed.
You are.
To say a few words on the Science Europe Working Group on research data, and I think I have only two more slides now. This working group has been in existence for about 3 years now, I believe, perhaps a bit more. There was a first mandate from 2014 to 2016, in which different results were produced. The main results you see on this slide. I trust that the slides will be made available so that you can, if you are interested, go to the links to have a look at the outcomes. Two papers were produced, actually one briefing paper and a workshop report on text and data mining. So that feeds back to the subject that I talked about in the Dutch dance context a moment before. We produced a report on funding of research data management and related infrastructures, and we produced a data glossary. Now we are in the second mandate, or actually that is coming to an end. And in the second mandate, we have been working on how to involve communities in research data management more intensively. And the approach, I'm not going to talk about it right now, but if you are interested in hearing more about what was done there, come tomorrow to the session in the RDA plenary meeting in the morning, I think at 10:30, and the links again will lead you to both the agenda for the meeting and to the draft report that we have produced. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Perhaps I use this one. I would kindly ask you to remember your questions at the end when we're going to have the panel. Just to say that thanks very much, Peter, because I think it's important to realize that there are all these tools that are being developed by communities in order to facilitate the resolution of complex legal issues through means of simplification of the information. And I think that's something we've seen a lot in copyright. And it's important to start seeing it in personal data, especially in the view of the new General Data Protection Regulation.